essential for these purposes. And these high throughput analyses include the RNA-seq data analysis, PIC-seq data analysis, these purposes, ATAC-seq data analysis, and also some cases, the some analysis which is done in the single cell level. So, of late, several molecules in CDRI are in advanced stage of development, and we really do not know some of their real target and pathways. Also, to improve the publication quality, these high throughput data are very, very essential. Besides, we are opening a center for bioinformatics and center for pharmacovigilance. So we need to have these capabilities within and need to have touch with some of the upcoming companies. This is what I thought of. In this angle, since I was working with Mr. Madhavan Vasudevan in this area, several other institutes, including IMDS, Delhi University, is also working with him, and very recently some of the non-coding data analysis from the liver biopsy he has done has made a really remarkable advancement of knowledge in the liver pathology. So today we have invited Madhavan
for giving a seminar on this high throughput data analysis, its difficulties, and how to address this. We are going to have a seminar from him. I have also requested him to interact with the faculties and the students. And eventually, I have requested him that we can have a 20-member, either from the younger faculties or the senior students, and workshop on this. The reason is, even if you cannot immediately do the pathway analysis, at least if the pathway analysis is done, you know how it has been done and you can judge the data. So this culture will be very, very important within us. And even though he comes from a commercial company, but over the period I have found him having a lot of academic interest, and that is why he has so many publications also, because he sacrificed his fees and get the authorship. We generally people don't do that. So I request, anybody is introducing Madhavan? Neeraj, are you going to introduce him? So otherwise I directly invite him for giving this. I think I will directly invite Madhavan to give a seminar, and already you have made a lot of friendship with him, so I'm sure people know you, and as we go along people will know you more. And I would suggest one thing before your seminar, if CDRI feels that you also feel, we can have an MOU with his company. So as we are having MOU with different institutions and these, industry, so one MOU with him could also be done under the proper terms and conditions. So during his visit, he may also please make a meeting arrangement with Naseem and try to see that one of the bioinformatics company. And I would request that if Dr. Ravi Shankar also, today he's not here, there is some sickness in his family, so that can also be thought of. With this, I request Madhavan to present a scientific seminar and interact with my colleagues and students eventually, so that we can work together for betterment of the drug discovery program. Thank you. You need these ones to put right there. So that we can take this and give it to there. And you can put the mouthpiece on here. Yeah, hello? This is my mic on. Yeah, yes.
Yeah, you are on. Yeah. Right. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Madhavan. And thank you, Professor Tapas, for bringing me here and giving me an opportunity to interact with the eminent scientist in CDRA. So, thank you one and all for your attendance here. With this, let me just directly go into my seminar. Alright, so briefly my topic of presentation today is on detangling the biological enigma from high throughput genomics data. So the reason behind having this topic is that ever since this deep sequencing evolved in the late 2000s, almost like 2005 in this country, a huge amount of genomics research has been kicked in for various purposes in this country. So what actually happened was the cost for generating high-throughput genomics data and deep sequencing based applications, new applications started coming in, which aided in a phenomenal change in the way the research was done. So having said, this is on the positive side. The big burden that we were carrying is on how to make any meaningful sense of such high throughput data. Right? When we are talking about doing a PCR for a couple of genes and trying to find out what the fate of them, where instead of a couple of genes, you've been given the complete genomic profile, how to entangle them, how to handle so much of information, how to clean the dust of the gold, how to use this filtering approach, right? So this had been a great challenge all the time. So in the course of time, we gained a lot of experience in handling multiple projects for multiple hypotheses, not just restricting to mammalian systems, but also bacterial, and we talk about fungal, plant. So name a living system, including the model systems, right? Zebra, fish, sea elegance. So it has been a pretty big challenge as to how do you handle such volumes of data and come up with some meaningful findings. So this has been the challenge in the last decade at least. So my seminar is probably going to help understand various applications which are in place, irrespective of the biological system you work on. And what kind of aspects actually entangle this data, right? And how, what will happen when you detangle the whole thing? What is the result of detangling? So I'm doing it primarily based on with this, I'll go to this next one. Before I'll go technical, little bit brief about me, self-introduction. So I'm a microbiologist from Madurai Kamaraj University, graduated in 1999. Bioinformatician by experience since 99, because lab was not fitting nice for me. So my breakage fee was more than my tuition fee. So I thought I'll get into bioinformatics. So apart from bioinformatics research, which I'm continuing, I handle roles in HR marketing, whatever the industry would demand. So that's something which I gain experience. So research work actually hit me in the early 2002, when I was with Institute of Bioinformatics. And then this thing is still active with collaborations over more than 500 scientists in the country and abroad. So I work very closely with so many scientists. So I've co-authored more than 60 publications in various impact journals, been acknowledged in few hundreds of them. And personal ambition is to reach a milestone of 100 publications before 3 years. So that's the personal ambition that I have. So on the right hand side is my top 5 publications based on the highest citations. So the very first thing I say is to talk about my research work with me, that was on the development of human proteome research database. So this is one of its kind we developed in Institute of Bioinformatics. So this currently is around 1243 citations. And then the second one was also very interesting work, which was directly into a pure bioinformatics paper towards identifying biomarkers in the serum for retinoblastoma, which is a cancer of childbirth, right? It's a cancer of eye. So the third one was again with Delhi University. It is a path-breaking work on potential drug candidates for M tuberculosis. So we actually came up with the workspace network analysis of two component system, which is a toxin antitoxin in MTB in response to stress. So this particular work comprised of challenging the bacteria with multiple antibiotics, multiple stress conditions, trying to figure out how these two component systems work and what kind of two component systems actually are triggered, actually are reproduced in different stress environments. So that was something which was very interesting work. Having said that, each of this work took close to a year purely on bioinformatics. It wasn't that easy at all. The reason being that the amount of data that was generated was very high. The total number of conditions we wanted to analyze was going in dozens of conditions. So it was more of a meta-analysis than anything else. So the fourth one was it was a personal privilege that I got to work with Professor Sarin on global mRNA expression profiling in hepatitis B. So this came in hepatology. So it was indeed a great pride for me to work with such eminent scientists like Professor Sarin. So again, this particular work took 3 years. So since the day we started this, it took 3 years to reach the publication. Right. The last one, but it's little old. This was with National Institute of Pathology with Professor Sunita Saxena. She just retired. So this was a very ambitious work in those days, which we talk about 2015-16. It's about integrating gene expression with methylation profile for esophageal cancer in Northeast population. So those days it was microarray days, but even then picking up a topic of trying to integrate epigenetic change with gene expression, identifying of potential markers was something which was a very early thought. And Dr. Sunita Saxena actually was fully confident that we could do it. So that was the fifth one. So this is the top 5 in terms of citation. As far as not everyone, but a handful of active collaborations I have, starting with people who are amazing set of comparisons. So anyone who wants to understand retinoblastoma purely from molecular perspective can simply refer to these publications. Dr. B.R. Shom is currently the acting director of Nivedi. He was like my guru and mentor for understanding veterinary part or animal pathology part. Professor N.K. Singh, who is National Professor of NABB, National Institute of Plant Biotechnology. We work closely on Brassica systems. So Professor Rozi Kumar Rangam, JNCSR. So he works largely on HAV and its variations and interactions with human. Dr. Neeti Chandra Mishra in ICGB. She works on non-protein-coding component of rice and its role in stress. And Professor K. Vijay Raghavan now, he was the director of NCBS, now he's with the government. So we got to work with him on novel genes that he had found which can regulate autophagy and other related stuff. Professor A.J. Rao is retired in ISC. So we worked on aging related studies in mouse. Sunita Saxena in NIOP. Dr. Padma Shastri, again on neuronal systems. Professor Sunil Mukherjee in ICGB. He was a guru in non-coding systems in plant. Dr. Raj Vadnagar. So he came up with an insect vector system for studying non-coding RNAs. Professor Amita Gupta again on UDSC on mycobacterium tuberculosis research. Professor Manikundla Kundu, Bose Institute, Kolkata. Again on epigenetic component for how mycobacterium tuberculosis actually works. Dr. Geeta Rai from BHU. So we did a very interesting project on children who are born with low weight and high weight. So what would be the differences in their molecular profile? So having said this, all of them are from a heterogeneous research environment. Some on plants, some on animal systems, some on pathogen systems. Some of them on real clinical science issues. So it was my privilege to work with all of them. They're actually giving me an opportunity to understand systems in a much deeper way. So this this insight actually aids in trying to connect an upcoming project with something which I have probably executed and share the experience and knowledge with a project which is coming in, to better understand and formulate the bioinformatics analysis so that from the raw data till arriving at a meaningful conclusion, it doesn't take much time. Though having said that, some of this publication took me even 3 years. Right? So it's practically impossible where from the raw data to publication, the shortest that has gone is 6 months. So this is the problem. So it's almost a problem. I guess this is the virtue of high throughput data. And this 6 months also is usually very thorough interaction on a day-to-day basis with myself and the collaborator. So we almost interact thrice a week. So that kind of interaction is mandate for us to take from the raw data till meaningful conclusion. So that's the HNI index. I don't know if, I mean, I really don't know what this means, but I guess it's a score for the kind of impact publications that you have. So this, somebody said if it is more than 10, it is okay, decent. So that's the reason I put. All right, so coming to the technical stuff. Okay, broadly, for most of you might be aware, the applications of high throughput genomics is broadly classified into three. One is epigenomic studies, transcriptome studies, and genome-wide studies. So the reason why I split into three is that why I put epigenome in the first, followed by transcriptome and genome, is the translational value of high-throughput genomics data is very high in epigenome studies, followed by transcriptome, then followed by genome-wide studies. I use this word called the translational value of this throughput data. So most of these epigenome studies, we have seen that the results that we get and the meanings that we get out of it is directly actionable. You can directly go to back to the lab and act on the finding and see that the whole system is either changed or it is reversed or it is induced. So in the last one decade, this one thing which I practically and thoroughly enjoyed and experienced is the benefit that comes out of it in terms of how a molecule is going to respond or act. The power of epigenome is much, much, much higher. So currently, epigenomic studies are understood as ChIP-seq, where you have a DNA binding protein or transcription factor or an activator or repressor. You want to find out at a particular condition, what are the genes that it's going to recruit, what it is not going to recruit, is it a positive or negative, it's an influencer. There is so much of nice information you'll get to know. So once you, ChIP-seq, as I've seen personally, it helps us to qualify or disqualify a particular DNA binding protein as, is it worth really chasing it to a potential drug target, right? So, ChIP-seq analysis today is far more improved than how it was earlier. ATAC-seq is a very recent, it's a replacement for the FASTseq. ATAC-seq gives resolution at so in-depth level to understand at a particular stage how much the chromatin is open, how much it is closed, and what is the ratio of opening and closing, what are the genes that are recruited, not just in terms of coding and non-coding, everything. So ATAC-seq is a very, very powerful technique. It has been evolved in a much higher way, but fortunately, not much people are doing in this country, or unfortunately, sorry. Right, not much people are doing, but I'm sure that sooner many of the studies will be coupled with epigenome studies followed by transcriptome. FASTseq was pre-ATAC-seq era. There were quite a bit of publications on FASTseq, but the sensitivity was reasonably less as compared to ATAC-seq. DNA methylation was there from ages. Initially, it was microarrays. DNA methylation was quite promising in terms of when it coupled with transcriptome studies. One of the papers that we saw on the esophageal was early studies on DNA methylation and transcriptome studies to understand how much of the methylated genes are expressed or not expressed. Histone modifications, another very interesting thing, primarily with focus of if you have lined up HDAC inhibitors, right, and you want to really understand the role of HDAC inhibitors. HDAC inhibitors are very famous now for most of the cancer treatments. So histone modification studies along with HDAC inhibitors gives a completely new perspective on how important these histone modifications play a role in many, not just in tumor or cancer, but also in developmental studies. So as of now, these are the broad epigenomic high throughput studies in place, and I would rate epigenomic data analysis as probably the most toughest as compared to the rest. This can be understood in that order as well, complicated till easy, right? Transcriptome studies, as of now, TCR sequencing is something which is very famous in this country, but TCR sequencing is actually giving a huge breakthrough in trying to understand how an immune system is in response to a lot of infectious diseases, even in cancer. I have an opportunity to bring this to this country through one of my friends in US who holds a patent on TCR sequencing. She has done close to around a few thousand TCR sequences for many cancers, infectious diseases, just to understand what could it's going to be economical. We should do TCR sequencing for most of the situations. It gives us a very, very meaningful data. MRI sequencing is a very standard thing. It has replaced microarrays to a large extent. In fact, doing an mRNA sequencing nowadays is cheaper than the microarray which used to do those days. So it would probably cost you $500. That's the maximum for an mRNA sequencing. So mRNA sequencing is becoming like a mandate for any kind of molecular work that we do. Small RNA sequencing, people do small RNA sequencing. The biggest issue with small RNA sequencing is, other than the miRNAs, the knowledge and information about many other small RNAs are very poorly understood, including piRNAs, siRNAs, shRNAs. As I'm saying this, the most important point to understand here is that without much information about the molecule, we cannot make much sense of the data that comes out, right? So choosing the right molecule to profile equally becomes important. In a typical small RNA sequencing, the major focus goes only on miRNA. Though there are some of the projects where my clients were interested in piRNAs, information available about the role of piRNAs is much, much, much limited as compared to miRNAs. So, but still, studies where people don't understand the regulation of mRNA by miRNAs, in that cases, it becomes very friendly, where from the total RNA, we do the mRNA profiling, from the same total RNA, we do the small RNA or the miRNA profiling. So this gives us a live information about what percentage of the transcriptome is regulated by the miRNAs. So people are interested in identifying miRNAs as potential candidates. A combination of mRNA and miRNA studies will give a phenomenal insight, not just in terms of the pathways that are regulated, but also what are the miRNAs which are regulating those pathways in the same system, right? So it's basically like hand in hand. That way, the value of mRNA and small RNA goes very good. Circular RNA sequencing, again, very poorly explored zone. Role of circular RNA is gaining huge potential throughout the globe, as good as TCR sequencing. Currently, again, in India, no one is providing circular RNA sequencing, again, thanks to my friend in US. So she wants to bring in all these technologies to this country through my company. So I'm still trying to explore how many people will be interested in circular RNA sequencing. So, but today, we are in the position to attempt projects on circular RNA sequencing. Total transcriptome sequencing is one thing where you want to completely resolve not just the coding, but also the long non-coding component. Again, said that percentage of link RNAs and its functional role, as far as mRNAs and its functional role, is 10%. So if 100 mRNAs role is known, only 10 link RNAs role is known in the ratio of mRNAs to mRNA. But said and done that, if you really find one or more, or maybe a dozen of link RNAs which are aberrantly expressed or aberrantly silenced, right? We can still try to get some sense or meaning out of it. Primarily, what it means is that if you're chasing some candidates which are really too highly present or too lowly present, we can still attribute the biological role of those long non-protein coding RNAs to the particular experimental condition we are working on. So total transcriptome is practically possible. We can do it. We are doing it here. I will talk about the experimental tangents. Now we'll talk about the genome-wide stuff. Genome-wide, most of the studies are restricted to microbial origin because when you talk about the human component, significant of genome-wide studies are in clinical. Either you do a whole exome sequencing to understand the mutations or insertions, deletions, structural variations, effect analysis, or GWAS studies, genome-wide association studies. But metagenome sequencing, again, restricted to microbial. Clinical exome, which is currently in practice for specific diseases, trying to sequence a panel of genes, see what kind of polymorphism and associate that polymorphism to how the disease is going to respond, how the disease is going to progress faster or slow. Whole genome sequencing is there in place, largely for organisms for which the genome is not present. So, let's say, for example, you identify a magical herb. It has wonderful medicinal properties, and you don't know the genome. Or if you know the genome, maybe you can find the enzymes and the metabolites. Then the need for a whole genome picks in. But said and done, getting a very highly resolved whole genome is still a big challenge. Typically, a large whole genome project takes something like 1 to 3 years to come to that kind of resolution where you almost map all the genes that are present in the genome and you try to identify the pathways or characterize the pathways. So it's not a part of functional genomic studies, but if you have a magical system in place, then you can probably think of a whole genome. Microbiome sequencing is purely from the drug discovery and other part is concerned. Metagenome and microbiome gives us insights to identifying potential pathogens or potential antimicrobial genes, antimicrobial resistant genes, which can cause a futuristic threat. If you ask me the question that is there a way that we could have did a surveillance or monitoring of COVID outbreak, if we had surveillance systems in place, why not COVID? We could probably identify any kind of pathogen, whether it's pandemic or endemic or epidemic outbreak. So there's a huge gain in interest on metagenome and microbiome if we are talking about pathogen and its surveillance and potential outbreak estimation. Mitochondrial genome sequencing, again, no one does whole mitochondrial genome sequencing. At least that is not available, because what people do is they do a whole genome sequencing and then they try to remove the nuclear genome and get the mitochondrial genome. That's true even for if you take plasmid genome, or if you take chloroplast, if you take plastid genome, any organelle genome sequencing, as of now, people do a whole genome sequencing and then they resolve it. Because it's quite impossible to elute only the mitochondrial DNA and then sequence it. This is again with my friend who bringing me TCR and circular RNA. So they have a method where you will get only the mitochondrial genome, even if you give the complete genomic DNA. So they have a method where they will resolve only the mitochondrial genome and sequence and give you. So that's another thing which I want to bring to this country. So this is how I am positioning the various applications of genomics, broadly classified into very complex, very valuable, practically possible, and there's a lot of downstream support that is required to make more sense. And then genomic studies to understand how a system is, how a system is changing that. So with this, I'll divide the whole downstream slides into each segment. Epigenome studies, we'll talk about how it is entangled, and how much it is tangled, what will happen when we entangle this, and how do we see this entangled part of this particular epigenome. Right, so how tangled is the raw genomics data? This again NGS-based. This starts with epigenomics. I've just lined up some 12 critical things which you'll probably take as a take-home message. First thing is, it's a quality of antibody. Because most of the epigenome studies depends on specific antibodies, which is going to help you pull the protein and then say what it is bound, right? Whether it's towards histone or a transcription factor. So monoclonal and specificity is something which one has to ascertain in a very high degree before you will attempt for any epigenome studies. This does not apply for genome-wide methylation, because you don't need antibody. You do a bisulfate conversion, which is a chemical modification. So that's simple and straightforward. You don't need an antibody for ataxic. So because that's also a chemical modification. But cases where you want to identify targets for a specific protein which binds, unless we have a really specific monoclonal antibody, it's almost like a noisy data. So that's one of the biggest, if you talk about how tangled, this is one of the biggest reasons. Second thing is the quantity of the IPDNA, that is immunoprecipitated DNA, which is a big challenge, right? So the lowest that you can have to attempt a chip sequencing is 10 nanogram. Getting a 10 nanogram of IPDNA is also not that easy. I seen projects where even after doing 100 pull-downs, you get only 5 nanogram, right? So this purely depends on how much what are the areas that this protein is occupying and how large it is, right? How much of the DNA that you want to pull down that's going to come, right? There are so much of variations out there. So quantity of the input DNA is very, very critical. Having said that, the another biggest lacuna is the input, right? So input, there is no antibody. You just do a formal fixing and then you get the DNA out. So issue with input, without input, it's a control, right? You need to compare the IP with the input. There is always a compromise coverage and depth. If you're working on a human cell line and then you have an input, the human genome is 3.2 GB, right? And you might generate something like 30 million reads, that's it. Now, 30 million reads is not going to give you 1x of the human genome. So basically, in the control, you are not even sequencing the genome 1x. You are sequencing random areas. You might not sequence some areas where the IP is giving you the information. So it's going to be a hell of confusion out there, right? So compromise coverage and depth, open chromatin regions tend to be fragmented easily than the closed regions. So this is a big issue. But there's no way that we can avoid it, right? So the current best practice that is going on is you do a biological replicate, or you do a replication of IP, right? And you increase the amount of data for the input so that you are not compromising on the coverage. So it means you have a good background to compare with the IP so that when you call the peaks, you're calling the peaks with a higher degree of sensitivity. Now, these are some things which normally doesn't come out of the protocol, doesn't actually tell us what is going to be the lacuna once you generate the data, right? So what we try to do is, based on the experience, we do a pre-calculation for this particular thing. We probably need 4x of the data for the input to precisely identify the peaks, right? So when you calculate or when you design an experiment, you have to keep all these things in place. So sequencing depth based on occupation and binding size, this has to be pre-calculated before we do a NGS experiment. So what we typically suggest is, once you have an IP, you can randomly pick up some regions for a qPCR just to see whether it's bound or not, right? So it should give you a fair idea as to what percentage of the genome is going to be occupied. So based on that, if, let's say, the occupation is only going to be 50 MB of the 3.2 GB. For 50 MB, if you put 100, 5 GB is more than enough, right? So you don't need to generate 10 GB or 20 GB because that's going to be only noisy. It's not going to give you peaks within neat and clean. Instead of a very sharp peak, it'll be more like blunt because there's too much of data there, right? So calculation of sequencing depth is very critical. So these points has directly to do with our pre-knowledge of the assay that we're doing, of the system that you're working on, right? What kind of protein are we looking at? For example, if the difference between an adapter protein and a transcription factor is very high, right? And not all the transcription factor binds to so many areas, right? So some kind of pre-biological knowledge will help us to calculate the sequencing depth, which will help us in return to precisely identify the peaks rather than false positive peaks. So the fifth one is stake reads are symptomatic of poor chip experiment. And it is stake reads, these are like, when you see reads like a ladder, right, it just means that we really did not do the sharing proper. So reads has to be more staggered than it's a stake reads. Right? So getting a staggered reads purely depends on how heterogeneous the fragmentation is, right? So why I'm saying this is that doing an IP experiment is a tough thing, right? I know people who do chip, the minimum time it takes to optimize a chip experiment is 6 months to 1 year. But once we are done, the information that will come out is going to be really novel. So that's the reason I put epigenome as the most toughest but most rewarding genomics experiment, right? So this one point has to be taken care of. Multiplexing is, this is like IP is done, let's say, right? Now, when you talk about sequencing, multiplexing is a very critical thing. So we need to make sure that whoever does the sequencing, whatever way that people multiplex, minimum X amount of reads has to be required in the single pass. So morning we shared some information about topping up, right? So many service providers do top up because you would have asked for n number of reads in one pass, they might have not got because of poor multiplex. So they top up. So when you top up, you are actually not doing a replicate. You are rerunning the same material. You are just adding data. So adding data is not the idea. The idea here is in one pass, we need X amount of data. So that has to be taken care. Unequal reads across samples will lead to normalization bias, including calculating the peaks, consensus peaks, which is purely based on statistical scores. So you might find the right peaks that's coming in, but the statistical scores will be very poor. It's just because in one replicate, it is like 1x depth, the other one it is 50x, right? So all these statistical tests keeps all these things under consideration. It might be a real true peak, but the statistics will not support you to call it as a true peak. So it is better that we have equal number of reads across the replicate samples, right? Initial days of chip sequencing, it is only single end. We used to do a single end 50 base pass, which was good enough for the chip sequencing. The reason being that the amount of data we require was less, and with a single end, you can still call peaks confidently. But the current acceptance is a bad in sequencing. The reason being that the cost is less now for a pattern. Single end is costlier than pattern. And the sensitivity is also very high because every fragment you read 3 to 5 and 5 to 3. So you are doubly reconfirming these reads and you are the base reads, right? So the algorithms are more comfortable and sensitive when they give a pattern data. Replicates, again, biological versus experimental. So what I mean by biological is you have two different batch of IPs done. Then you consider them, it could be pooled, no problem, but two different batch of IPs. Experimental is you don't have enough antibody left, but you have so much material, you just make two portions of it, and then you sequence it. Right? So it's again an option. Ideal is biological, but if you have enough antibody to make biological replicates, most ideal. Cases where we have a lack of antibody, experimental replicates are still allowed because there is no way in one pull down you will get enough material for sequencing, so which is allowed as a norm. A ninth point here is adapter contamination and removal. In chip-seq, this is the biggest headache because any pull down is like small RNA. You will not get an occupied region more than 50 base or 60 base, right? But your sequencing read will be 150, and there's going to be a lot of adapter which is contaminated. You don't even know where you want to chop. Like sometimes you will add adapter thinking that it's a part of the chromatin, which is wrong. So this step is very, very critical. So as I told, why ATAC-seq is getting more popular is because there is a unique quality control for ATAC-seq to say whether there is an adapter or not, right? Because it is not based on antibody. So things of at least in epigenome studies, or chromatin studies, the improvement in gaining sensitivity is going in a phenomenal way. So adapter contamination removal is a very, very critical step. Tenth is alignment and peak calling, and or differentially methylated. The criterion sensitivity has to be decided by the scientist. How much, what is the percentage of alignment you expect? What is the peak calling?
It's by 415. Because 415 is only booked for something else.
Okay. All right. Okay. Yeah, I guess yeah, I should do. All right. Fine. So this is another point which has to be taken into consideration. Downstream data analysis is a two-way work from the bioinformatician and the scientist discussing about what kind of biological analysis, including pathways, GEOs, and regulatory networks. That's another input. Without that, you're not going to make any sense of it. tools and bioinformatics pipelines with the least false positive ratio. So this is the job of the bioinformatician. However, said and done, the role of a scientist to agree to, yeah, I think we are following the gold standard pipeline, right, is very, very essential. Now, the reason why I put these 12 points here is these are the things which are going to add to the enigma of tangling the whole thing, right? One of the 12 is compromised, it still remains tangled, right? If you really want a neat and clean and a very reliable finding, one has to address all the 12 points before we actually think that, yes, we did a good shape-seeking experiment. And this is a no-book rule book, right? Well, no one has this rule book. All these things come sort of working with so many projects, right? So many failures, right? So that's the reason I wanted to emphasize on this. Having said that, each one point is important. At least you will have an option to ignore or not ignore, but the decision will be on the scientist's part. From the bioinformatics point of view, it will be collectively discussed. Like for me, I will collectively discuss. We will agree on the flexibility. We'll agree on the compromise and sensitivity, and then we take it forward so that the results are more meaningful. So that's just an image. The slide will be shared. So the entangled data is going to look usually if you properly entangle it, right? These are some of the publications, right? The one, the four of this is where I have contributed, largely with Professor Tapas. And some of this is an ataxic paper. It's an ataxic paper, identification of transcription factor using ataxic, very first paper. This is histone methylation and acetylation ratios, tensile paper about FASIC. Chip-seq, this is about tissue specificity, and this is H3K4 hot air. This is for the MTB part with Manikundla Mundu. And this one is about histone chaperones, right? This is that combination paper, gene expression methylation. This is about the back condition leads to mastitis. And what is the epigenetic response to the infection? So you can use epigenetics to study everything, right? Because there's a host and pathogen interaction. And the pathogen, when it interacts with the host, it creates some epigenetic changes, right? And if you understand the change, either you can clear the pathogen or you can target the host, which will trigger an immune response to clear the pathogen. So it's a hand-in-hand story, right? And P300 mediated butyrylation, this is probably one of the papers which talks about butyrylation in P300 as a critical thing for adipogenesis. So usually they have a good job done will lead to some of these kind of publications. So I'm happy that some of them I contributed. And this is how we normally a good chip-seq or epigenome paper analysis look. The first one is the network that we found, which came on the cover page of epigenetic journal. And typically, second one is the integrative genomics, where you want to visualize the peaks in a specific area, basically for differential peak enrichment. How does it even look? Because you want to see to believe it, right? And the one below here is the...
Use the pointer. Can you please set pointer for him?
Internet pointer. On the screen. Right, so this one is basically to compare various methylation or various IPS, right, in a specific TSS 1KB window, how the differential recruitment is. Like, for example, this is against a protein. This is against a phosphomutant of the same. This is about one of the histone. This is an acetylation mark. This is a methylation mark. So it is quite obvious to see that there's a differential recruitment of the protein and its mutant as compared to nothing by the acetylation mark. So these are some representations which gives you the merit of your assay. From the publication point of view, the reviewers don't ask any question because it's done. It's obvious, right? What you're saying is right, finished. Let's go next. That's how it goes. So, and then when you talk about the different areas that are recruited, more on intronic, extronic, or in the TSS or TETS, all these things are mandated. So this one is about the core biological network that comes, about the genes that are recruited and what kind of pathways they regulate, how they come together, what are the likely genes which are playing the bridging role. So most of these are software related only, but there's no one software which does it. So for each of these questions, you have to depend on multiple tools and algorithms. But said and done that, we will have a visualization as to how am I going to present this whole information? How am I going to tell that I have entangled all the complexities and I'm giving the resolution which one has to believe? Said and done, a typical epigenome analysis work takes 6 months to 1 year. So that's a typical time that you're looking at. Okay, going next, this is about the transcriptome. Again, 12 points. I'll run through. Quality of the total RNA mandate. There is no exception here, right? Whether it is from exosomal or whatever you want to do, mRNA, small RNA, circular, total RNA quality is mandate. Quantity is also very, very important depending on the type of application. For an mRNA, you can go as low as 100 nanogram. For an mRNA, you need probably a little more because mRNA is much lesser component of mRNA. And circular RNA is even lesser than miRNA. So smaller the molecule you target, more the material you will require. And said then more the material, the starting material will be total RNA only. And it will be an integrated high quality RNA, right? So you can just run a bion laser or tape station. So subunits has to be intact. So that's a mandate. So these things, if you compromise there, then you're compromising in every next downstream. Biological replicates are mandate for any publication today. There is no RNA-seq paper you can publish without biological replicates. Most recommended is triplicate if it fits your budget. Fourth is the sequencing depth. Depth here refers to amount of data. The global recommendation is around 20 to 30 million. There is always a confusion about the million reads and GB data, which is not true. So GB is not equal to million reads. So if the read length is 100 base, so 3 GB data is 300 million. So 30 million, sorry. 3 GB data is 30 million. If it is 150 base, it is only 20 million. So if someone sees 3 GB data, and if you need 30 million, then you would go for 100 million. So 100 base as the read length. So it is never hand in hand. So you always ask for million reads. The million reads recommendation here refers to global standards 20 to 30 million for an RNA sequence, mRNA sequence. Total RNA is 50 million, small RNA is 10 million. So these are minimum required. So there are standards for this. So one has to look into that as well. Efficiency in RNA depletion, 100% RNA depletion impossible. So whichever RNA sequencing that requires removal of ribosomal RNA, you cannot achieve 100%, 10% carry forward minimum will be there. What it means is 10% of the data will go waste, will be not used, right? So, which means that you will eat into the number of million reads that you want, right? Multiplexing, again, the same issue we spoke in the epigenome. The amount of data for each of the replicates should be not more than 20% standard deviation. No topping up again. Right. And if there is if one sample, it is 30 million, another one is 100 million, it will affect the normalization. So in such cases, we do not take the data at all. So these are things which will give a strong emphasis because all this will directly have an impact on the downstream statistical and differential expression analysis. So pattern sequencing mandate again, like SIGNOW. Same replicates story, biological or experimental cases where we do this sorting, sorted cells RNA-seq, right, or single-cell RNA-seq, we will not have much of the RNA. In such cases, experimental replicates are fine, right? So detection of splice variants and novel isoforms is still a challenge, but if you have a GTF file with proper TSS information, then identifying novel splice variants is possible. But otherwise, whatever they say that this is also a new isoform might not be true, right? So false positives in splice variants and isoforms are very, very high. So de novo transcriptome where there is no genome is still a challenge because of an annotation in the assembly. So it cannot be equated to a normal mRNA resequencing where the genome is already available. Downstream analysis vary from project to project, organism to organism. So there is no standard analysis one can do for an RNA sequencing because the questions that will be asked for two different conditions in mRNA-seq will be completely different. Right? The questions you'll ask in a liver biology is different from a neuronal biology. Right? So downstream analysis will be the most complex in terms of mRNA sequencing. These are something which we'll have to give that as an input. Right? Small RNA analysis is refined only for resolving mRNA, I told you, not for other small RNAs. So if you do a small RNA sequencing, you will have loads of information about other small RNAs, but it's just in the cold storage. So we might not do much with that, but it's still a goldmine of information, right? Again, planning a transcriptome, this is the most tangled aspects which are in place. Normally, when it's entangled, such nice publications come. I guess this is all where I bought the different study from biology. So each one of them is a different question. So this one took 3 years. That's why the impact came. And this one took actually by almost 3 years. It went to BioRevix and then finally came. And this one did not take much. This took 6 months, if I'm not wrong. This one also took 6 months, if I'm not wrong. This is with, I guess, Shivshankar Rai. This one did, it took almost 6 months. So typically, unless and until it's a real clinical large cohort, 6 months you will be able to hit it. That's a nice part of RNA-seq studies. So there's some of the nice papers. So what are nice ways that we can show? So some of them are mandate. Whenever you do a replicate, PCS mandate, this is mandate to show your experiments was reproducible. It's a mandate. This is a mandate volcano plot to show whether upregulation is more or down, right? This correlation matrix is mandate to show how the replicates are. Like this are triplicates, they have to be together. These are triplicates, they have to be together. So these are some of the important representations which shows the merit of the whole experiment. And this is the box plot of different pathways in GO. So the size is directly proportional to the number of genes. The color is directly proportional to the p-value. Right? So all these are self-explanatory. And you can ask for this, because none of these are difficult. And somebody who knows how to do it will give you. But if you ask as part of standard report, none of these you will get. As a part of standard report, everyone gives you some standard stuff which may not be of any use. Purely from publication point of view, you might want to give some resolution. Like this is a classical thing. It's going to come out now. This is Tapaska, Akashka. This is about two different compound combinations. This compound actually has induced a lot of genes which are required for neuronal plasticity. Whereas that one of the molecule attached, there's nothing much which is inducing. So how will you even show this? How will you show that adding a one molecule is actually triggering a cluster of genes, right? And these are visual representations. For me, it is like advertisements, right? You just show this and they say, okay, I see to believe it, right? So see to believe it representations are very critical to avoid as many questions regarding how you arrived at the final conclusion. So, which I think is the most important part of entangling any high throughput data. So, for me, meaning of entangling is from that so complex, how did it come to these nice representations? It looks neat and clean. It gives me sense of what I'm actually going to show, right? Okay, the last one about whole genome DNA. Largely, it is related to microbial. So, existing 16S, it resolves only till genus level. Fungal, again, very less fungal ideal genomes are known. So, not all the fungal ideal genomes are known. Whole microbiome is more promising but expensive and significant data loss, because if you do a whole microbiome of a gut, human gut, data will have more of human genome, human genomic DNA than the microbial DNA. So there will be loss of data as well. So contamination from original genome has to be taken into consideration. Whenever you do a bacterial genome, you will get carry forward of plasmid genome. So, but nuclear genome is different from an organelle genome. We need to remove that contamination. Pure mitochondrial genome is currently patented and expensive. Endosymbionts to be taken into consideration. If you do a, even if you do a protozoan or parasite genome, they will have endosymbionts. When you crush and take the DNA, you will get the endosymbiont DNA also. And when you try to assemble that genome, what will you do with the reads from the endosymbiont? So that will create noise when you do the assembly. Endosymbionts has to be taken care of. Whole exome targeted does not give uniform coverage from common. Means if you do whole exome for a cohort of 100 people, the 100 people, all exomes will not be covered. The total number of exons which will be covered in all of them will be 60 to 70% of the exons that are known. So 30% of the exons information you will not get in 100 samples. But there can be very important exons. So, hence whole exome or targeted is not promising if you want 100% coverage. If you want 100% coverage, best is amplicon sequence. Right, so targeted amplicon sequencing is the most cost effective, and some of the nice representations. This is for the whole genome DNA. Last but not least, I personally feel best way to entangle is integrate. Methylation with gene expression, mRNA with miRNA, right? ChIP-seq with mRNA-seq, right? You do a whole exome with transcriptome. When you do for the same system, if you do two, that becomes very easy. And getting to the right information is much, much more easy, right? This is how the entangled things look. And what's my promise? I normally prefer consultation to be included from the experimental design till publication for as a part of the collaboration. Competitive and economical will be the promise without any scientific acceptance or compromise on scientific. Dedicated support post completion of all the standard analysis. My TMX initiative, I want to do this, include hands-on training for the scholar who is attached to the project on essential bioinformatics, because I don't want things to be a black box. So collaboratively conduct workshops and trainings on data analysis for genomic data. Thank you for the time. And just one last statement, COVID-19 seems to be an author of divisions, taking on new variations every now. So let's unite together for better hygiene and safety precautions to ensure it cannot challenge the nature of God. I started believing the nature of God because of COVID. Just in 3 days, I see that it's doubling. So,
great.
Thank you.
So, since it is time that about 15 to other team will come, we will not have the question time.
4 to 5 sessions.
So, in the next session, you can just have the question answer session.
Those who are interested to talk to Dr. Madhavan in person, please come to 105 room and you can have question answers over there in physical interactions from 4 to 5. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.